Iran has provided the European Union with its final conclusion on the talks aimed at reviving the 2015 nuclear agreement and is now awaiting the U.S. response.
I think that by 12 o'clock tonight, we will submit our final conclusion on the remaining issues between us in writing to the European Union coordinator.
Earlier on Monday, Foreign Minister Hossein Amir Abdollahian said Tehran would offer its final conclusion on the JCPOA revival talks by midnight local time. He added that Iran sees no obstacle to a revived deal if its red lines are respected. The top diplomat said that Washington must show flexibility and a realistic approach if it wants to restore the nuclear accord known as the JCPOA. Amir Abdollahian said that it would not be the end of the world if the U.S. fails to do so. He warned that Iran has its own plan B if the JCPOA revival talks fail.
They talk about Plan B. We also have our own Plan B, but we believe that in the end, this matter should be resolved with the realistic approach of all parties through negotiations.
The Iranian foreign minister made the comments 1 week after the EU put forward what it called a final text on the JCPOA revival, following 4 days of indirect talks between the U.S. and Iran in the Austrian capital. The JCPOA was thrown into chaos after the U.S. unilaterally withdrew in 2018 and reimposed sanctions on Iran. The remaining parties to the accord have held several rounds of negotiations to restore the deal since last year. Let's bring in Alexander Azadgan, who is an academic and political analyst, in order to get his views on the talks and where it stands. At this point, Alexander Azadgan, first of all, welcome. We're looking at a response that Iran has given, but there still seems to be a few points that, as Iran has said, there needs to be flexibility in particular and only by the U.S. in order for a deal to be reached. What is your reading into what has occurred so far?
Good to be with you, Kaveh, and our audience, of course. I don't think anything is going to come out of it. You know, we have a saying here that past performance is indicative of future performance. We've been told for several years that we are at a pivotal, point in JCPOA. We've been told that it's come down to the IRGC being taken out of the FTO list, foreign terrorist organization that Washington put them in. I think at the heart of this is what's happening right now, at least, is we're getting this from both sides, from Iran and P4+1. It's a media messaging thing. It's information operation. It's public diplomacy. You can even say it's a psyop media warfare. The ultimate goal, I think, for Iran, for the role that they want Iran to play, is what they call regime change. I don't like that phrase at all. I just call it the systematic destabilization. That's what they want. Is Iran negotiating its geopolitical and regional and even internal politics when it comes to the JCPOA? I think so, because this is what made it comprehensive. Originally, the JCPOA was only supposed to be over the nuclear matter. So I think the conservatives in Iran want to have some kind of a relationship with the U.S., at the same time maintain their position toward China and Russia. We are at a point where Iran is signing a 30-year contract of cooperation agreement with China, a 25-year agreement with Russia. Iran is literally at the crossroads. The soul of Iran in the next few decades is going to be determined by the JCPOA, especially after the Ukrainian conflict, in terms of Russia trying to pull Iran towards its own direction. Russia was really never pro-JCPOA because Russia wants Iran to shift to the east, not necessarily to the west. And we heard today that the Russians announced their openness in selling some of the most advanced weaponry they have to some of their allies. They didn't say exactly who, but I think we know who they're talking about. So basically, everybody's looking at Iran with all its resources. We're looking at Iran being one of the top five, having the top five reserves of oil, top five reserves of natural gas, and so many other rare earth elements and minerals. Everybody wants their hands on this. Iran's GDP pre-COVID if JCPOA was were to be implemented, it was promised to increase to over $460 billion annually. They call it the liberalization of the Iranian economy. This is it's a sizable amount. And then from the internal U.S. politics, Kaveh, I don't think Biden would want to be perceived as an appeasing president when it comes to Iran, for which he will be harshly attacked by the MAGA Trumpist, Make America Great, you know, again, Trumpist. Nancy Pelosi pulled that stunt by going to Taiwan, trying to bolster an image of power to China, the rest of the world. This was completely coordinated with the White House, regardless of what the Biden administration says. And the Democrats will lose both the House and the presidency in the next 2 years. So not to mention the fact that our foreign policy in your region, in West Asia, is completely being taken hostage by the Israeli lobby here in the United States. So we are at a point where we are, I think it's a collapse of meaning when it comes to the JCPOA. We have this concept that Iran is promoting the de-Westernization of West Asia, the de-Americanization of West Asia. This is not going to fly well with the party of war in Washington, neo-lib and neocon. JCPOA was never a good was never signed in good faith. It had a contingency plan to corner, in my opinion, and sabotage Iran. So it was a bad deal and a DOA, dead on arrival deal. Those who negotiated it in good faith were dangerously, in my opinion, naive amateurs who put people's lives and livelihoods in grave danger. Superpowers, Kaveh, by definition, are imposing expansionist and hegemonic in nature. All they want, all they're interested in, is expanding their sphere of influence, then tightening the belt, or shall we say the noose, and chokehold to demand more concessions. And if they do act in good faith, in parentheses, quotation marks, it's out of geopolitical expediency, not principle. It's all the same, U.S., Russia, China, and soon to be India.
Thank you so much for that. We appreciate it. Thanks for your input. Alexander Azadgan, academic and political analyst. Pleasure to see you.